I've been shaping boards for about 35 years, a little longer. Shape, you know, I don't know how. I mean, I stopped counting because it was kind of making me feel old. But, you know, well over 50,000 surfboards by hand, you know. And I was a sculptor major in college. I don't look at just people as being different. I look at them as being really different. So when I look at anybody, I block them off. I see the shapes in their bodies, in their faces, and everything like that. So that's what I do with surfboards as well. When we make a board, we have a plan. And the board is designed for a specific use. And when I make a 10-foot PBU, pray before use board, that's meant to ride a 30-foot, 20-foot wave. And that won't ride a 2-foot wave. So each one of these boards is a unique board for a specific job. You know, a surfboard, we look at the outside of a surfboard, we probably can tell pretty much what it's for. To know your purpose and what you were designed for, a person has to look in the inside of themselves. Because even though people might look differently on the outside, it's more what goes on the inside of a person.
I don't think we were really expecting anything to happen the night before.
No, it was being born 6 weeks early. They said, we're not sure if he's going to make it.
He was 3 pounds and 4 ounces. He could fit in the palm of my hand. He was born with pneumonia. His heart stopped 2 times. And I remember praying to God, please, you know, whatever you can do to help make him healthy, so don't let him die on me. And he didn't. I thank the Lord I had a hold on him from day one. He answered my prayer.
From what I can see, knowing that my life could have been taken from me at birth, but it wasn't, and then seeing everything else unfold, yeah, there is a bigger picture and there is a bigger plan.
The Outer Banks, years ago, everyone was older. There wasn't a younger generation. There was very, very few young kids, if any, that were surfing.
This little grommet, about this big, I used to see him hanging out down at 3rd Street, 2nd Street, whenever the waves were good. I always knew he was always pretty special, even when he was young, even beyond his year.
I just saw these 2 blonde-haired kids just taking off on anything and just getting wiped out and come back up laughing and giggling. And I paddled out to one of them. I go, what's your name? He goes, Noah Snyder. And I was like, you're doing all right. You got a lot of heart.
It just seemed like all of us, we knew that he had arrived. The pulse in the water was, there was a young boy that had come out of the pack that was local, that was just really had all the right moves, and just he was in another zone.
Oh yeah, he wasn't scared of anything. He'd go on anything. And I just kept thinking, oh man, he's better than I am. I think he was 15. I was like, he's better than me, you know?
When I first started surfing, some of the guys that I looked up to were Barry Price, Lynn Schell, my dad, Stuart Taylor, Billy Diggs, just a lot of local surfers. Well, Barry Price, he had the moves in the water, the style, he had it all. And Stuart Taylor, I mean, he was raw. He charged. He'd pull into waves that would literally probably scare most people. And I remember specifically seeing this picture of him in Puerto Escondido, and he's doing a bottom turn, and there's probably 30 foot of face plus. And I just sat there, and I remember just looking at this photo going like, this guy's crazy.
He had to follow in a lot of shadows. You know, all those guys charged. They'd all been to Hawaii, Mexico, Puerto Rico. So, you know, he'd hear stories of those guys and probably think, wow, you know, I can do that.
He was on the shoulder more than once looking in, wide-eyed and bushy-tailed, going, yeah. Lynn Schell was making him just some really good surfboards. WRV picked him up, like plucked him right out of the talent pool and said, this kid is going to be good.
When I met him, we actually became friends and surfed a lot together. And we traveled to Hawaii together his first winter. I think it was 1990. He surfed really well. You could see that it really suited him. He enjoyed the more powerful waves, and he wasn't as intimidated as some people coming from the East Coast.
And then it was shortly afterwards that I realized that it was not just him, but it was just a whole handful of surfers. They actually traveled in a group.
We were all friends. I mean, you're talking about an area where, you know, old guys and young kids are all going out surfing together at any given time. All those guys kind of had their own unique style, and all of them evolved differently. Jesse Hines, without a doubt, Noah's protege.
He used to take me surfing all the time. He actually just helped me a lot in surfing, you know, encouraged me, and just, I was surfing with one of the best surfers on the beach.
And then there was Matt Beecham. Matt Beecham was the trickster. He was the first guy I saw that kind of had the long sleeve, black rash guard, the slicked back Slater look, very skatey style, and always the hugest smile on his face.
Growing up, just it was so inspiring just to see Noah surf and just ripping and doing it in a way that's unique to Noah.
Brent McCoy, call him Pepe, he makes the best prime rib on the Outer Banks.
Noah's legs look like two of my legs put together. Yeah, he don't have no chicken legs.
And Craig Watson has always been the guy there for Noah. I think Craig is actually responsible for, you know, getting Noah into some of the larger surf when he was a younger kid. You know, he wanted him to charge. And then there was Brad Beecham.
We were very close friends, the whole crew. But there was a difference because it was the things, the activities that we were doing, the way that we were carrying on.
Grant Doyle, we called him Chicken. He was a very kind of sarcastic kind of kid. He was hilarious. And then there was Jamie Smith.
You know, Jesse and Brent especially, they ran with a pretty tough crowd, man. And they were groomed into this party lifestyle at a young age.
We would go around, you know, 10, 15 of us sometimes to a party.
When they showed up, you just knew there was gonna be mayhem going on.
Usually included beer and breaking things. They were punks, and I was one of them.
They had that core group of friends. And then when you get out in the water and you see that all these guys can actually surf really well, it is intimidating for outsiders, man, you know? I mean, these kids can do whatever they want.
The good days that we get, those handful, that dozen days of full-on, like, small Escondido-type barrels we get down on Pea Island, I'm sure that honed Noah for his forays into Hawaii. You learn how to barrel ride growing up around here.
Obviously, the waves around here are just, you know, they actually have a lot of power to them, and that's why, you know, especially people from Florida love coming up here, and it kind of goes from deep water and then it goes to shallow really, really quick, right on the sand. So most of the times you're dropping in, getting barreled, and then when you're coming out, you're like almost jumping off your board, running on sand. It makes it fun because you can get a lot of waves, and especially as a kid, when you surf a wave that's right next to the beach, you just, I mean, your wave count is quadrupled of what you would be as you're surfing a point break or something. That's just fun, that's exciting, you know? And you end up staying out for like 4 or 5 hours and not even know it because you're just catching wave after wave. It just makes it fun, that much fun, I think.
The Outer Banks is located in the mid-Atlantic region. There's miles of coastline on the Outer Banks still that just haven't been touched.
All we are here is a strip of sand. There's no city.
It's just a laid-back place with an island sort of atmosphere where you get kind of lost and forget there's a whole other world out there.
You just get to see the stillness, the quietness, the wildlife. Those are all the things that, you know, I just greatly appreciate about this place.
The Outer Banks was this, like this magic playground. Once you hit that water, once you walked over those dunes, once you felt the sand and you had the sea oats, it was like that magical feeling of the lure of the ocean.
Never seen a community of surfers like the Outer Banks, ever. Even nowadays, as soon as I head over that last stretch of bridge and I can just see Kitty Hawk in the distance, it's like everything that's going on in my life just is completely thrown out of my pores. Like, I feel rejuvenated as soon as, you know, I land in Dare County.
It's always been my home. It's always been, you know, where I've felt and I've had peace. Just thankful to have grown up in a place like this. I've had the chance to travel all over the world and see a lot of different places, and I'm just still always so stoked to come home.
If you grow up on the Outer Banks, you gotta learn to make your own fun.
Our summers are definitely pretty flat. I mean, it'd drive you crazy.
We just wait in anticipation each year for hurricane season. That's the best ways we get all year.
You know it's coming, you know the swell is on its way. You've been sitting around all summer, it's been flat, and you've just dreamed about a hurricane swell, and finally it's coming. You're just like dying just to see it.
When a hurricane's on its way to the Outer Banks, normally what you'll see first is the swell. So normally about 2 days before the hurricane, you actually get good waves and the winds aren't there yet. And usually that's a great time to get some good surfing in. The earth levitates, DJs store records and crates. As I concentrate to generate a mandate that will irritate those who stagnate. My culture reupholster MCs like furniture. Then sign my autograph, receive burnt lips from Seraphim and Seraph. Now I write deadly paragraphs and leave devastating aftermaths that smash the paths of wicked officials, cause their ways are superficial. I step on them like stair climbing aerobics.
Everybody gets real excited when a storm's coming. We all get glued to our TVs just trying to figure out what in the world these storms are going to do. And Jim Cantore is kind of a legend. He's one of the weathermen who's just brought us the storms for the last 15 years.
People don't realize the power of water. I mean, water weighs 60 pounds a square foot. You know, you're talking about a square foot box like this. That's it, 60 pounds. It's almost an incompressible liquid. So when you think about a 10, 12 foot wave and all that water coming hammering down on you, you all take a beating out there.
Yeah, we do.
Seriously. Once every 5 years, Cape Hatteras can get nailed by a hurricane.
When a hurricane actually hits, it's just like, it's a hurricane. So it's the winds are blowing, trees are waving, and rain's like banging on your windows. The whole coast is just getting hammered.
It's such a fragile existence on the Outer Banks. One storm goes into sound, the whole island's gonna be underwater.
There's stuff flying in the air. It's pretty devastating, but the power that comes out of those storms is amazing. Crazy how much energy those storms have. It's pretty heavy. you would just see the expressions on people's faces. I mean, some of them were just in complete disbelief, and other people just looked like they had the rug pulled out from underneath of them. I mean, people's houses were lost. I mean, people's dreams were vanished and gone just like that. Hurricanes, they bring destruction, they bring craziness, but they bring waves.
Storms constantly shift the sandbars. I mean, we'll have a sandbar for a week, and then the next week it'll be gone. Because it's always shifting, you have to constantly drive. Especially when there's good waves, we drive for like an hour just to find the spot, because there's always like the hint or the thought of somewhere better.
When the waves come up, I know there's a place that's happening, and I just want to find it. It
turned into a thing after a while where people would just see Noah's car on the side of the road and assume that that was the best break, that he had already checked everywhere from Kitty Hawk to Frisco. So we used to say he had to paint his car every week just to keep the crowd away.
Well, pretty much most of the waves that we have here are just round, hollow, filthy barrels. If you get a good barrel, it's like you're looking at this curtain. White water is just hitting you in the face. It's like this suction, like train ride. You're just freaking out, and then when you can come out of one of those, it's like you just conquered the world. I mean, you are stoked.
Noah was being considered possibly one of the best surfers to ever come out of the Outer Banks.
He established a reputation at first, you know, and then got the professional career later.
I turned pro at 21. It entailed just having to travel and to get out and to leave your home.
It's a very working class, blue collar community, a lot of builders, a lot of fishermen. So it's really kind of ironic that a surf star would come out of a place like the Outer Banks.
We'll be right back.
And he really did carve the path for all the surfers to follow. He was the first pro surfer ever on the Outer Banks, the first to really make it, the first to really make a name for himself internationally.
He's just a local kid who grew up and started living his dream.
I've known Noah since I was probably 13 years old. I mean, I always came up here and stayed with those guys, and they always opened up everything they had. It gets cold here in the wintertime, so I always try to return the favor and invite them back. And Noah's a powerhouse, dude. He'll drive down to Florida, 14 hours, to drive right back in a day. He's like, I'm not even phased, I'll drive the whole way. They used to come down and hang out, especially for like King of the Peak and contests we'd have, and I'd surf with them, and it was fun.
I would go down to Florida and stay with CJ and Damien and Buddy. I remember I had been in Florida for like a month, and I hung out with Will Tant for probably like a two-week stretch. I was just actually getting to know him.
Noah and I were just, you know, hanging out down in Cocoa Beach, shooting photos with Mez and Dugan, and we were just surfing and hanging out, and he seemed really content with what was going on from the outside look, you know, but I guess on the inside it was just a completely different story.
When I was in Florida, I just had time to reflect on my life and just kind of seeing where I was with everything. I just noticed that I had fears, I had doubts. I just felt kind of empty. You know, I felt just dry. I just felt like I was just, you know, running on no gas. And
it's not like he was, you know, down in the dumps, you know, drug addict, you know, thieving. He was already doing everything right, you know. He was in the magazines. He had a pretty successful professional career that was budding into something bigger. He was making money. He had everything.
At that time in my life, you know, I kind of had everything I ever wanted. My surf career was going good, but I noticed that I wasn't completely fulfilled. Like, there was definitely something still missing, and I was trying to fill it with something, you know, and I couldn't seem to, like, find it. The only place that I knew to turn was just home.
Woke up and Noah was basically gone. He was like, all right, I gotta go. He didn't really explain too much why or what was going on or anything like that. And he was just packing his boards and his bags and taking off to head home.
Pretty much on my drive home, I was thinking a lot.
I knew something wasn't like physically wrong with me, but inside it was like I was dying. I wasn't alive.
I prayed a prayer in my car because I had always believed in God. I had always prayed to him every now and then at that time. And I was like, God, I don't really know what to do. I'm like, Lord, I don't know if you hear this, but this is what's on my heart. Well, after I drove back home from Florida, there was this one day that I specifically remember. You know, I woke up in the morning and went down and checked to surf, and I knew that it was cold. The water was 39 degrees, and it was a little warmer on land, but not much. Even the seagulls weren't even getting close to it. When the water's this chilly, you need something that's a minimum of like a 5 mil wetsuit. You gotta have gloves, boots, a hood. The only thing that is not covered is your face. I knew it was going to be a challenge, but after seeing a few waves break, I knew that I was out there. You're pretty much only going to last about an hour and a half before your body begins and wants to shut down. Feel like bricks. There's times I've gotten out of the water and I've gone to grab my keys and I haven't even been able to open my door because my hands just don't work. And I came in and I ran into my good friend, and I hadn't seen him in forever. And we just talked and just shared with one another just what had been going on in our lives. About a week later, I was at his house and he just simply just invited me to church. He's like, hey man, you know, what are you doing on Sunday? And I was just like, you know, I don't know. I'm like, what's going on? He's like, well, why don't you meet me at church in the morning? I'm like, all right, where? And he's like, meet me at the Ark.
If you want to back up on any questions, by all means, okay. I mean, maybe this became infamous.
They grew up in the culture of going out every night. They didn't know anything but surfing and partying.
You have your friends around you all the time, you're egging each other on, you know, and it was fun for a season, but then everything was in like disarray. Whether you were hungover, somebody was mad at you, you never had like a real peace or a real joy and fulfillment, you know, although you portrayed like you did and you acted like you did.
What I do remember is that we were all at pretty dark stages in our lives.
I was like 16 at the time, and I tried to quit partying, but I just couldn't do it. I couldn't do it on my own, and I was just down and out, and I needed something to lift me back up.
It got to be a lonely place, even in the middle of you know, a whole group of friends all the time.
You know, I grew up in a broken family. I was definitely the kind of kid that just wanted to belong.
You know, I was 17, and I began to think about life. What am I going to do, and what is life? You know, what is truth, you know, what is it? It was like, what, are you supposed to be a monk? Or are you supposed to like go out and do good things all the time? I picked up a Bible one day, and the answers were real clear to me in there. It was a Bible that had Jesus's words in red, and everything that he said just pierced my heart, and it made so much sense, and it just was complete opposite of what I was doing and what I had been doing. I didn't know what to do, but I was not about to tell anybody.
My mom had always taken me to church, and there's things going on in my life that I wanted to change, and I know the only way that I could change them was to somehow get connected with God again.
We just kind of all decided that you know, we were going to go to church before we went surfing one Sunday, and just kind of nonchalantly went about it when each of us had things in our heart that we probably didn't want the other one to know.
The Ark Church, it doesn't look like a church, it looks like a boat on the side of the road. And when I showed up, there were three of my other friends there that I hadn't seen in a while.
The fact that Jesse, me, Brant, and Noah were in church on the same day, or even in a church, was a sheer miracle.
Like, we had a special guest, and that guest was preaching.
My family never went to church, so I really didn't know much, if anything, about Jesus Christ. So this was all new to me.
I didn't really know it, you know, but Noah was in the same place that I was as far as wanting a change.
As he began to share these stories, it was like I kind of woke up. At one point in the service, I just knew that God was speaking directly into my heart.
Looking at each other's faces, we were all feeling the same exact thing.
As he was speaking, he brought clarity.
There was a light, seemed like, that came on the inside.
I mean, I found out Jesus is Lord. No questions, no doubts. I mean, he was Lord of my life. But probably the biggest thing that I also found out is that how much he really loves me.
He gave the invitation to accept Christ. He laid the challenge on the table, and we all took it. And that's when I truly, you know, asked God to change me.
And I was praying to God. This is one of the first times I was really praying. And I just had this unbelievable amount of peace where literally all the hurt and the pain and the things of my childhood were just getting like opened up. And God was coming in and healing me.
I just always had this weight of guilt constantly, you know, that I couldn't really explain. But when I prayed to Jesus to forgive me of the things I knew I'd done wrong, that weight had left. You know, I felt like, physically felt like weight was lifted off my shoulders. And I found exactly what I was looking for, which was just peace and forgiveness.
What I saw when I prayed and what I felt, I know that this is real. And at the same time, my good friends right then made that commitment.
I mean, for years, I was just doing my own thing, turning my back on God here and turning my back on God there, and yet he still loved me through all those mistakes and all those things that I did. And I realized that Jesus did pay the price for us, and that's what he did for me. He paid the price for all of our wrongs. He nailed them to the cross. And when he nailed them to the cross, he said, you know, it is done.
my brother and I were in college and we had taken a semester off and we were just spending time in Hawaii and Craig Watson was there and we were just having a ball.
I grew up in a Christian home. I was in church almost every Sunday. My mom and dad got me there bright and early. I had heard all the Old Testament stories, I had heard about Jesus, so I had a lot of familiarity with some of the things of God, but I had no relationship with him. Over time, I became very stale and I became very stagnant.
Brad and I were surfing with Craig a lot, and evidently he had accepted the Lord like a day before he came to Hawaii.
A friend of mine came over to my house and asked for God to come into my life, and he came into my heart right there, standing in my driveway. Not in a church, not in normal places where you think you would go to meet God, but God met me right there in my driveway.
Brad and I were actually, even though we'd been Christians our whole lives, we were actually reading the New Testament for the very first time for ourselves, you know, actually reading it straight through just to like figure out what's going on here. And we were having such a good time with it, and God was doing so much repair in my heart.
And when we began to develop that intimate relationship, that's where the real joy and the real excitement to my life really began.
Got a phone call from my mom, and she was like, "Did you hear what happened to Noah, Jesse, Brant, and Jamie?" And I was like, "No." And she's like, "They went to church, and evidently they accepted Jesus." And I was like, "No way."
Yeah, I mean, we heard the no on those guys, you know, hey, some weird stuff's going off in Hatteras, those guys are getting saved. They told me, and I just went one ear out the other. I was like, you know, just kind of, yeah, right, we'll see what happens when we get up there, you know?
At first, I wasn't into it. I was like, whatever, cool. You know, they'll be over it in a week.
I wanted to know, was it really real? Did they really have a life-changing experience, or were they just down and out, and the trouble had hit them, and they were just... You know, they weren't really sure.
We get home. It didn't take much more than just looking into our friend's eyes that we know like the back of our hands. That's the most amazing miracle I've ever seen. To look in their eyes and see something that was not there before and see a hope that they're feeding off of and living off of now that was not there.
We were just new, you know, and there was no words to explain it, but we all just saw on each other's faces. It was like a whole new life started from right there.
For the first time in my life, I let go and I stopped caring what people thought. And it was very liberating for me.
My heart was changed, my views were changed, my love for people was changed. I mean, you know, and that for me was one of the biggest miracles of my life, was just how I viewed others.
We were there for each other, and I can remember those guys being real friends to me. They would actually say, "Jamie, you know, how are you doing? You know, no, really, how are you really doing? Let's talk about some of the struggles."
That energized my life so much to see God swoop in and change even the way these guys would look at me, their friend. It was a totally new deal.
So there was always the commonality of surfing within the group, but when we all had accepted Christ into our hearts, there was one huge factor that brought us all together. No matter how different each of us are, we all agreed on one thing, and that is that Jesus is Lord of our lives.
I knew him as a surfer beforehand, and we could always share that passion, you know, that love of the ocean, that love of surfing, but I would see how the Lord was giving him things that this world couldn't. And it reminded me that I needed to go and find the nearest Bible and read it and really get to know the Lord.
It was like automatic. As soon as we walked out of church, I think we had a Bible study that night. And it was, we knew that's what we needed to do. We just knew that we needed to pick up the Bible and learn, you know, who is this God?
We came home, and I mean, they were having like nightly Bible studies. Me and Brad were just tripping that we were about to go to a Bible study at Noah's house.
I've never had that good of a time my whole life, ever. No matter what party, what girlfriend, what wave, anything, as being, you know, in unity with friends and at peace with God.
It's a choice that everybody had made, and it's something deep down inside I respected. You know, I didn't know it at the time, but I knew when it came to my time, I dealt with a lot of the same stuff that I saw them deal with. I realized that it wasn't on the outside, it wasn't what everyone else was doing. I realized that it was God directly talking to me.
One by one, guys were just expressing how heavy an impact, you know, that it had on them.
I could tell that, you know, something had taken place in his life and something was very real.
You know, that's when we really started thinking about it. We're like, well, yeah, no, these guys have changed up there, you know? And we could see a change, and that was the difference, you know, as opposed to hearing someone's a Christian and actually seeing it acted out as an example. And
the change was my heart. I didn't look different or all my problems weren't solved, but my heart was changed. It was soft. It was available to love and available to be loved. And I felt free. I felt totally set free, and I felt like a brand new kid again.
Those things that I'm so thankful for throughout my life, you can't really think about it or even put a finger on it sometimes. It's just God moving. You know, it sounds weird, it sounds all that stuff, but if you go back and look and how all this stuff happened and how it played out and how it affected our lives and how much we've been blessed through everything, and it's pretty neat. We kept hearing this stuff, and then me and Buddy and Damien had did this road trip up here. Buddy was my roommate at the time, and he's been my roommate since I can remember.
We had went up there, and the water dropped really cold, and the waves got bad, so we decided to cut our trip early. And as we're pulling out of the driveway, backing up, literally, I remember just we were fully backing up, and Noah comes yelling out of his door, going, "Hey, I just got invited to Barbados with Welsh, and I'll drive back so we can just carpool together and someone can ride with me."
I remember we stopped at a rest stop, and dude, Buddy's like, "Man, dude, you don't know what's going on. How long have we been on the road for?" I'm like, "Dude, we've been on the road for like 10 hours, you know?" He's like, "Dude, it feels like an hour, dude. Me and Noah just been talking about God and the Lord and Jesus and what he did and all this stuff." And I'm like, "Yeah, right on, cool. You know, I heard that was, I've been going on down here, and I heard, you know, a couple of the boys got saved, and that's insane, you know? I wasn't like bagging them or anything." And I was like, "Sweet, man." And Buddy was just cloud nine, just so pumped up.
I ended up seeing Noah's life change, and it was just ridiculous. It wasn't just a, "Hey, this is something I kind of figured out." It was like a Mack truck, you know, had hit his life, and he was so changed, and God was so real at that point.
And I went to church, and I was Catholic, and I'm like, you know, I knew God, but I didn't have a personal relationship. It was like, all right, God was an hour on Sunday, killer, you do great things, but, you know, I still have my life.
My heart was so soft and so broken, and I so knew that there was nothing else. This was the only option. There was such an overwhelming feeling in the car, and it was God saying, this is it, this is your time. I remember asking him, how do I receive the Lord? And he's like, you know what, man, I don't even really know the prayer. And I was just like, oh no, you know? And he said, but I have a DC Talk CD that does, it has the prayer on it. So I remember he threw it in the CD player and cranked it up. And we got to that prayer, and I prayed it from the bottom of my heart.
The snowball started going on up here, and then we just had our own little snowball that started going on down our way. And how thankful I am that Noah shared with Buddy, and ultimately his faith growing started affecting my life and just where I'm at now. And if I had to go back and start putting, you know, fingerprints on everything, I'm thankful that God was working in people's lives, that ultimately he was working in my life.
As a shaper, I see God's hand in everything, and he really did make every single person a unique person. Like, I look at these guys as being, they're all kind of buddies and partners, and they all love Jesus, and yet each one of those guys is so radically different from each other. There's no question that God has a specific plan for each person, and we don't know that plan unless we submit to him and just follow him.
Everybody's story, each one has his own path, each one has his own struggles. For me, just seeing that I could have been taken at birth, but I wasn't, and then seeing what God has done since my birth until now, is just obviously, you know, the plan that God had for my life.
So this is a story of faith. It's a unique story because it affects the lives of so many.
Now that we're older, you know, if he looked up to me at that point, it's me that looks up to him now. That's how much of an impact he's left on me.
I think in Noah's story, I looked at all the pressure that he had and he had to stand up to, you know, because it's not easy. You're standing up to the world, pretty much. He was like one of the first persons to stand up around here with the crew that he was hanging out, and he had a big influence on everyone, and he never, ever looked back.
Whatever was going through his head and his heart was truly genuine, and I think it was all the same with those guys. Otherwise, they all would have dropped like flies. What are we, like 8 years later now?
Just seeing Noah's life, you know, he was a professional surfer at the time, had everything in the world going for him, but he didn't have God.
Noah's story makes me look at myself and say, what really matters in my life? What's going to be there when it's all said and done?
These guys truly have friendship. Through good times, through bad times, they shine forth what friendship is all about.
I've had the most fun the past 8 years of my life that I've had, period. Being a Christian and living for God has been fun. It's been hard. I mean, don't get me wrong here. It's hard too, but it's fun. More than anything, it's fun because it's real. It's about just being real with yourself and being real with God and coming to him as you are and letting him just take the reins.
You are the open door to freedom. You are the only hope I have. The reason in my reason. The only thing that lasts. How could I begin to settle when all within me longs to step into the shelter of your everlasting arms? I wanna get carried away. I wanna get tossed by your waves. I don't care where or how deep. I'm gonna jump in with both feet. I wanna get carried away. In your ways, I wanna be held by your truth. I wanna behold all of you. I'm gonna be all yours today. I wanna get carried away. You are the wisdom of the ages. You are the one who stays the same. The power in the wind, the sand left by the rain. How could I begin to make it if all I had was me? Just take me as I am, Lord, and sweep me out to sea. I wanna get carried away. I wanna be tossed by your waves. I don't care. Jump in with both feet.
not only has God brought Noah into an unreal surfing career and given him all the desires of his heart, but above that and beyond that, God's given him a wife, Carissa.
A story is being told while simultaneously another story is beginning.
Hey, but Noah's gonna have a son. I think it might, the saga continues with his son after this.
The surfer community has been such an awesome blessing to this community. And we just thank the Lord for Noah's friendship, he and his wife, Carissa.
It's a story of a dream that young people have held in their heart, that they finally find out who put the dream in their heart, who made them, who fashioned them in their mother's womb, and who will help them and lead them through all the challenges of life.
You know, and it's a moment where, you know, my life is continually changing and continually I'm learning, and it's not the end, it's just the beginning.
God's forgiveness and his love is available anywhere, anytime. It can be you out surfing one day and you realize that you need something more, it can be anywhere.
I think young people have to embrace that this is a way of life, this is life. The life of a believer is an abundant life.
He has done this for us, and all we have to do is believe and accept that.
God has the most amazing plan for your life, and he has things that you could have never dreamed of, but you just have to let him. You have to believe. You have to take the step of faith and say, you know what, God, here I am, exposed. And once you do, there are going to be things that you're going to do in your life that you are going to be in awe of.
I realized that there was another way to life, and I think that's what a lot of kids are faced with today. They just see the way of the world, and they think that that is the only way, and it's not. In the Word of God, it says that if you draw near to God, he's going to draw near to you. So basically, if you really want to see God, you're going to see him, because his Word says, you know, that as soon as you take the step to go for him, that he's going to be right there.
Falling, I am falling down the mountain once again. Falling, I am falling down the mountain once again. Does anybody know this man? Can anybody understand how long it is the road we've come today? Day is now wrapped in silence. I wonder what is this violence? Keeps his mouth locked shut and his tongue at bay. Falling, I am falling down the mountain once again. Falling, I am falling down the mountain once again.
Just appeared. How can they say you're not real when I feel you here? How can they say that you're not real? You're in the wind of the waves. You're all I feel. amidst the storm. Yeah!